Hello, this is Mark from My Keys to Music, and in this video we're talking about connecting your Nord keyboard to your computer. For those of you who've been wanting to record sounds into your computer, I have a great way to get started with this if you've never done it before. Then this video might be something of interest. It really starts you off at the very, very, very basics. It does assume that you own a Macintosh, and we are going to be using a free program that comes with most modern Macs. It's called GarageBand. So we're going to use GarageBand to record sounds from our Nord keyboard into the computer. So this has been requested by this particular subscriber, and it was a good question. The question asks, any chance you know how to plug the Nord Stage 3 to Logic Pro X and make a recording? I can connect it via USB and get a signal, but there's no audio output. Now, Logic Pro X is sort of the big brother to GarageBand. It's the paid version of a digital audio workstation. But we're going to start with GarageBand because, like I said, as long as you have a late model Macintosh or fairly late model Macintosh, GarageBand should be at your fingertips. The only other element you might need, besides the keyboard itself, of course, which I assume you already have, is an audio interface or a mixing board that can convert the audio signal, the analog audio signal, into something the computer understands by way of a USB port. Typically, that's how this is done. All right, in this lesson, we're talking about connecting your Nord keyboard to the computer. So we have here a handy-dandy Nord Stage 3 at our fingertips, and we want to record straight audio. So the analog audio signal that comes from your Nord keyboard, the left and right outputs, what you would normally send to speakers or what you'd normally send to a mixing board, which would eventually get to a PA. That's the connections I'm talking about. I'm not talking about the USB port. I'm not talking about MIDI, I'm just talking about analog audio signal, the most traditional, the most basic recording sound into your computer. All right, so you're going to need something that converts that audio signal into something the computer understands, which is primarily a digital signal. So digital to audio, or audio to digital in this case. What you need, and one of the tools you can use, this is not the only tool, but this is one of the tools, and one that I really have been using for a while. It's called the Focusrite Scarlett 18i8. It's called an audio interface, and it interfaces between that analog signal you get from the keyboard and the computer. Not only does it take care of audio, this particular device also handles MIDI as well, so you could say that it's dual function. Now, you don't necessarily need an audio interface like this. You could actually get a mixing board, and you can connect your keyboard to the mixing board, and then from the mixing board, you can take a USB out and bring that into the computer, and that's also another way of converting audio signal. But for now, we're talking about audio interface, and I'll put a link for this down below in the description. So this is the back of it right here. You can see here, I've blown that up a little bigger for you to see. And I'm going to show you how I connect my keyboard to the audio interface. In fact, this audio interface has been used for the last several years. It supplies all the interface work for the entire channel as well as all the courses. So it is a workhorse. I use it every single day, hours and hours a day. So you take the audio signal, the left and right channel, and I plug it into the back of the Focusrite. And I'm using channel 7 and 8 for this example. Now you might say, well, why don't you just plug it into 1 and 2 in the front? Well, the front panel of this over here, these are more leaning towards individual mono inputs, such as a microphone, or let's say a guitar or a bass guitar. These are considered mono inputs. They're not really readily designed for stereo, although if you combine 1 and 2, you can actually have a stereo left and right. But for now, I'm going to put these in 7 and 8, and the only reason I didn't put it in 5 and 6 is because in my example, when we actually connect this, I happen to have currently connected the keyboard into 7 and 8. I believe I connect one keyboard to 7 and 8 and another keyboard in 5 and 6, so that's the only reason I'm using 7 and 8. All right, so the next thing we talk about, and probably the most important and powerful connection here, is the USB connection, which is sort of the old-fashioned USB, but for some reason, music manufacturers love this older style USB connection port, and they've adopted it. And today they're creating music components that still use this first generation, in a sense, USB port. But that's going to directly connect to a computer of your choice. Now, in this particular demonstration and tutorial, we're going to be using a Macintosh computer. I use that because that's what I have, that's what I've been using, and that's, frankly, is used in a lot of different music studios all across the country here in the US, and I'm sure all over the world. There's a great many people using Windows as well, but for now we'll use a Mac. And on that Macintosh, we'll be loading a program called GarageBand, which, again, I keep saying this, it's a free complimentary app that comes installed on your computer. GarageBand is also available for the iOS device, but again, this example, we'll be using GarageBand on the computer. I think it's a little easier to use, and it is more feature-rich than the iPad version or the iOS version. Now, GarageBand is also known as a digital audio workstation, and I know that you've seen this term, the DAW, D-A-W, thrown about all over. So few people talk about what that actually means, but it means digital audio workstation. And really, it's just nothing more than fancy terminology for a program that orchestrates your sound and or your MIDI. It's essentially a music composer and arranger. It's a way to store your music and store the settings for all the different things you do to control that music. It's primarily used for recording music, recording songs. All right, so that's the digital audio workstation. Then we have the input of GarageBand is set to the Focusrite as well as the output. So this USB here, this port, is continuously and constantly talking to the app GarageBand. You could say it's a marriage between GarageBand and Focusrite. It's an absolute handshake that goes both ways. And all the settings travel on that one cable back and forth. That's really where the magic happens. So in order to hear all of this, I most of the time use headphones. And I simply connect the headphones to the front jack on the Focusrite. This particular model of the Focusrite has an option for two headphones, which is very convenient if you're doing things like podcasting, or if you're just composing with somebody and you want to have two people hear it at the same time, you and a partner, let's say, it's very handy to have that second jack, although you could jimmy-rig a single jack into two headphones with an adapter. So that's my entire setup. That's how I do 90% of all either music composition or recording. Certainly all the videos and things like that when you're hearing me record my Nord keyboards, it's all going through the Focusrite, and all of that happens through this one box. So it's really the one box does it all. It bridges the gap between the computer and the keyboard. So like I said earlier, you could switch this Focusrite out with a full-on mixing board. A lot of mixing boards today do, in fact, allow you to bridge that gap between analog audio and digital, and they do the same thing as the Focusrite. I like the Focusrite because it includes the MIDI option. It's also a very clean and quiet unit. It's professional. It's been well battle-tested over the years, and they have just a lot of different options, every size and flavor you can imagine. So I really like this as a solution. Plus, I only really need two keyboards connected at any one time for most of my stuff. So what we're going to do now on this next part of the video is we're going to actually connect this up to GarageBand, and you'll see me do a basic recording. Just know that this whole connection is happening here in the background. When you look at me do this, you'll know that this is how it's all connected. All right, let's go to the second part of the lesson. Let's open up GarageBand, and I'll create a brand new project. The very first thing it's going to ask me to do is create a new track, and it's asking me the track type. And as of this recording, I have four track types. I have the USB and MIDI option. I have the audio input, which is the one we're going to be using today. I have a standard connect a guitar or bass. And then finally, the virtual drummer, where we're going to add a drum track. So for this purpose, we are going to use the audio recording or record a microphone or line input. And that's technically what we're doing here with the keyboard is a line input. Now, I didn't pick the MIDI option, even though it has the keyboard on it, because that would be a whole nother lesson to connect to MIDI and drive the software instruments of GarageBand from an external keyboard. What we're actually wanting to do in this video is record the audio from our Nord keyboard so that we can record it, what we actually hear, into the GarageBand. Now, if you recall from the previous part of this video, you saw that I had an audio interface, and I mentioned that I would be using input 7 and 8. So that's what I'll be using here, a stereo input 7 and 8 acting as a stereo single track, but as a stereo-type track. That's why the circles overlap each other. So that's input 7 and 8 from the audio interface. And then it gives me this other option here that says, I want to hear my instrument as I play and record. And in other words, you want to monitor the recording as you're recording it. And that usually is what you want in this particular case. So I'll do that now, and I have now created my first audio track. And if I've got everything connected to the keyboard and the computer properly, and I've set up the audio interface as it needs to be, I should be able to just click on the keyboard and hear audio, which you heard there, hopefully a bass sound. And you'll see that this indicator here indicates whether I'm going to monitor the input or not. So in this case, I will monitor the input. Now, recording couldn't be easier at this point. The setup is the bare. Once you get it all set up, then the recording is easy. And some would argue that the setup is actually easy too. Well, it's only easy if you really know and have worked with your audio interface, you know where everything connects and things like that. Once you do get it connected though, it is actually easy. There's really only a few more options before we can actually start to record. I have a metronome count in, so we actually have one bar ahead of the actual recording. And then we have the click track, which allows us to keep in tempo while we record, assuming that the drums aren't already there. It's awfully nice having a click track. So I will go with this click track. I'll click the record button up here. And so long as my cursor is on this particular track, I should be able to record. All right, so I recorded about 2.5 measures there. Let's hear it back. I'll just hit the return key, and it should bring my scrubber all the way back to the beginning, and then I'll hit the space key. And sure enough, I have sound. Now you'll note that I can barely see any audio lines here. It looks like the recording was very low in the mix and very low, and that's generally not a good idea. In fact, as I'm pushing on here, you can see that my green lines aren't anywhere near the yellow or the red, which would be closer to the right side of this scale. So in other words, I want to give it more input. So all I probably need to do is just adjust the overall sound on my Nord keyboard, and it wouldn't surprise me if it needed the volume all the way up. There we go. I've just turned the volume all the way up. Let's listen to see if we can see a difference. I can definitely hear a difference, and I can see that those green lines are much longer and giving us a better recording. So let me record that again, this time with a little bit more volume, and we should have just a better quality recording. Okay, this time I did just over 4 measures. Let's hear that back. You can certainly see the lines are there now. Of course, it's going to capture every aspect of your performance, including the mistakes. And you could get to the point where you can edit this and actually clear out some notes and change some things. You can even quantize the real audio file here, well, which is now a digital file. So there's a lot more you can do, but that is the basics of how you record into GarageBand. Let's go and erase this. I'll just select on it and hit the delete key. Let's go ahead and create a new virtual drummer track. We had threatened that a moment ago. All right, so now we have East-based Max. Let's just listen to what that sounds. I'll hit the Enter key in the space bar just to hear those drums. Let's pick another drummer. Let's go to Jesse Funk Rock, and we'll go Retro Rock, and we'll see what that sounds like. All right, that's pretty good. Let's record something. We'll still keep the click track, so that, and then we'll have the 4 count in, and then we'll start, this time, record right against the drummer. I'm just hitting R on the keyboard for recording. Okay, let's hear that back. Okay, so I'm going to just trim this down here. So I'm going to put my scrubber on the measure between 4 and 5, and I'm going to hit the T key, the Command T key. And that will trim that. And then this time I will just stretch this, essentially looping it for 8 measures instead of the original 4. Let's just listen to that. Ideally, this is one way to go. You can record your Nord keyboards directly into GarageBand. What a lot of people do instead is actually use any keyboard they have as a MIDI controller, and they record MIDI notes into GarageBand and then have the software instruments play those notes back. And that usually works for most people. I'd say that most of the way recording is done today, or at least in a beginning sense when they're using GarageBand, that's what happens. They're recording MIDI instruments, not so much recording actual sound, unless it's coming from, let's say, an external guitar or a microphone or some other instrument that can't be duplicated very well with soft instruments. But we have a Nord keyboard at our hands, or at least most of you do, so the opportunity to record those good pianos and things like that exists. Now, you could get the best of both worlds, which is really advanced, which means that you could record MIDI into Logic Pro X, and you could quantize it, clean it up as need be. Then you can send that MIDI back out to the Nord, thereby hearing the Nord sounds from the MIDI. Logic Pro X can do that. And then finally, you would record those completed performances from the Nord keyboard back into Logic. So you sort of go round robin a couple times to get to the end result. But that's fairly complicated. That would really take a whole course to properly explain and to fully understand. But that is what you can graduate to in a perfect world. And I think that's how, ideally, you'd get the most flexibility. Because when you have your performance in a MIDI format, you can do clever things like transpose, you can take notes out, add notes in very easily, you can move things around very easily. Not that you can't move it around in the audio world. Things have really advanced to the point where you can almost do all of that in the audio world, meaning you can just take these sound waves and manipulate them as well. But I don't think it's as easy or as straightforward as doing it through straight MIDI, at least not for me it isn't. So this is your beginning lesson. We learned how to open up GarageBand, create a new track, assign it to the audio interface, and click the record button. We then learned how to work with the different levels. We learned a little bit, a very little bit, about trimming that track and then extending it and looping it for 8 measures. And we learned how to add a virtual drummer. So those are the very, very basics. If you want to learn more about GarageBand, there's a lot of training on YouTube, as you can imagine. You can also find training with an entity called Udemy, and I'll put a link down below in the description. This is where I received all my AWS certification training, my computer training, but they also have a lot of great music training for GarageBand, Logic Pro X, many of the top digital audio workstations, even some synthesizer training on selected keyboards. So this really is a highly recommended entity if you're looking to further your training in these areas. So that would be something I would recommend if you are interested in taking this to the next level, but it really can be definitely a labor of love. You could definitely lose a lot of time to this stuff, but at the end of the day, it can also be very fun and very rewarding. It's fairly technical, but it's also very artistic. So that is our lesson today, to record the Nord keyboard into GarageBand. Just the basics, and we'll catch you on the next one.